So I will start from where Isabel stopped her session. So she explained about as a consumer, what's the expectation from a service provider, and the frustration that she faced as well as most of the other consumers are facing, that not getting enough service. So the digital experience basically provide an answer for that, that it provides the service and then more value than the service that a consumer is expecting. So to explain it or to simplify it, I will use a few examples. The first example is Uber. I think most of you are aware of Uber, even it operates here. So Uber and a traditional taxi, it's a totally different experience. Especially you connect with the driver before you get into the Uber, as well as a driver connect with you before you get into the taxi. And then since the Uber system works based on the rating, they give you a better service as well. Like usually they give you a water bottle and the car is clean, and relatively you get a better vehicle than a normal taxi. And then again, after you take Uber, after you finish your ride, then you will get a receipt in digital format. So it's a completely different experience to the usual taxis that you use. The second example, I'm not sure you are aware of this device. It's called Amazon Dash. So when you need to buy something, usual experience is you go to a shopping, a department store or a shopping mall and then buy your goods. But Amazon Dash give you a different experience, that most of the things that you need to reorder or you buy regularly, you can order it in a simple way. So this is Amazon Dash for detergent, the washing powder. So usually what happens, you stick the Amazon Dash in your washing machine, and you configure your account, and whenever you want to reorder, you just press a button. Like even a 6-year-old kid can just do the reorder. So actually, this is my daughter. She's trying to order it, but luckily she's not tall enough to touch the button. So it's not only the washing powder, like any consumer good like that, you can reorder using this device. It's a really better experience and make your life easy. So next experience is basically, this is called Amazon Echo, or called Alexa, that it can recognize your voice and do certain stuff. So you can link that Amazon Dash to the Amazon Echo, and then rather than pressing the button, you can tell, okay, reorder this whatever the stuff that you want to buy using this device. Even I use it to check weather and then find the fastest route, so and so forth. Then the next example is electric or a connected car. So it's not about the electric car. I think Harsha and Veshandak, they gave a clear or a detailed explanation about how an electric car works. So this is about one of our colleagues who drives Tesla. He explained that when he drives into his home, there's a place that he wants to lift the car because otherwise it will hit the car will hit the ground. So he started doing this thing daily. And then after a while, like after a week or two, the car identified whenever he come near that particular position, it automatically lifts the car and then give him a better experience. So those are a couple of experience how this digital transformation helps consumers to have a better consumer experience. So let's look at the architecture a little bit. This is not a technical architecture, this is about the business architecture behind these digital enterprises. The first thing is, it's about customer experience, not the same way. It's a real-time experience that it's giving. I think Isabel explained it in detail about how the big data can use to give a real-time experience. And then it's a personalized experience. It's completely personalized for you based on the information that these systems can process and then provide information. Then the third thing is it's geosensitive. From where you are, based on that, it provides information. So Uber is a good example. Like, based on your location, it tells these are the vehicles available and then what you can consume. Then the next thing is predictive, because it collect the data and then give you some set of information. So the Tesla example is a better example, because it predict when you come near that to lift the car like that. So it's a new set of customer experience provided by these digital solutions. Then this digital experience creates something called a digital double. So that's basically the physical person is there, and then when they are consuming these services from the digital world, it creates a proxy or a virtual person inside these systems called a digital double. So digital double is the one who communicate with data, then services, and the different type of business processes and provide this service. So addition to the digital double, it creates something called a digital workspace. So that is basically the user experience, or the digital workspace can be an application, it can be a web app, or it can be a car. Depending on the solution, it differs. And then it connects to the social experience, it connects to the business side of it, because all these things are related to some kind of a business, and then it connects to the knowledge or the information provided for this particular person. So to simplify this, I will use an example. So I don't know how it works here, but in US, these dating apps are very popular among singles people. So people use these applications because it provides accurate information than traditional matchmaking. Because what these applications are doing, it connects to your Facebook and find about your information. It identify what type of music you like to listen by based on you purchase from iTunes, and then it look at it looks at what type of movies you are watching based on the tickets that you purchase. Like that, it collect all this information and do a better matching of each and every person. So so how the digital double work with this experience? Basically, because of the digital double, you miss your first date, because digital doubles will do the first date and match and have a digital conversation, and you will get a chance to do your second date. So even when you have a nap, these digital doubles will communicate and try to find the matching partner. So that's an example how the digital doubles work in a digital workspace. So if you look at it, kind of a layered architecture, how it works, you have the person, and then you have set of applications, and then underneath there's a platform to run these applications, and then there's a network or connectivity layer that connect different type of applications. So that's how it, if you look at it from a layered architecture, it looks like. Then if we look at these digital ecosystems, you get web app type of systems. Those are kind of social networks that we use, like Facebook, Twitter, those type of stuff. And then there are mobile apps, mainly like gaming, geo apps, sort of applications that you find. And then the second thing we call two-side platforms. Those are like applications and people connect, like financial services, because those are not shared. It will be the person who holds the account and the banking system. Or it can be a citizen service that the government connect with the person and provide information. So that's a two-side platforms that we find. And then there are multi-site platforms. Those are called, like, as example, healthcare. Because to provide information about a patient, these systems need to connect with multiple systems and then kind of mash up this data and provide correct information. Then the next thing is kind of citizen services. So number of government applications or systems should connect together and then provide information about a citizen. Then the last thing is called the value network. So those are the ones that provide a lot of services or value for a consumer. As an example, a smart city and a connected car or a smart hotel is a value network that provides a lot of value through digital enterprises. Then I picked this quote from Gartner. So what they are telling things like less about the fixed processes, because most of the time these days, like what we are building are fixed processes, and then try to convince the consumer to use the fixed process. But what they are asking to do, like think more about dynamic interaction, and then build your applications and services based on that rather than stick to the fixed processes. So this interaction actually are kind of, there are four levels of interaction. First thing is human to machine, and then second thing is human to human, and then machine to machine, and machine to human. So with the digital transformation or digital enterprises, human to human interactions are getting less, because that's one issue actually, because you will not contact with human to human, but you contact with the human, it will be through some kind of a digital channel. So I will give you an example from my day-to-day life. So I have around 20 to 30 minute commute to office from the place that I live. I live in San Jose, and then office is in Mountain View. So usually I take this famous California highway called 101. So 101 is really unpredictable. So it might take 20 minutes or 30 minutes. So I usually leave home around 8:30. So thanks to our account management team, most of the time I have a customer call at 9 o'clock. So I had to make somehow commute to office by 9. And so I'm a fan of tea. So I have my breakfast. During my breakfast, I have my tea, but I need another tea before I start working. So there's a Starbucks, a coffee shop just opposite our office. So usually I run to the Starbucks and then get my tea. So if I am late, then what I'll do, I'll dial from my mobile and then run there, stay in the queue, and then get my tea and come back. But sometimes I can't do that based on the time I'm coming. So recently, actually, 3 to 4 months back, they introduced something called No Time, No Line, that you can order your tea or coffee online, as well as they look at my history and time, tell what I should order as well. So now what I'll do, like there's a traffic light just before I take the turn. When I stuck at the traffic light, I order this thing, order my tea, and then quickly go and pick it up and come. So the human-to-human interaction, how got affected, like before this system came into the place, they usually call me, okay, hey, Asanka, how are you, like that, and then they get my order and do it. And then again, like the format of Starbucks, basically, there's less permanent staff. A lot of students, they do part-time jobs. So whenever the staff changes, like basically when seniors call me, like the new staff started talking on my name. So that kind of a relationship we had. And then again, like if I am missing, they ask from other staff whether I'm traveling, so and so forth. So after I started using this application, now they call me like a web order or the web user, because they are not worried about calling my name, because there's no kind of a human interaction happening with that. So that's the experience and the downside of this digital transformation. We get a lot of value, but we miss some kind of human interaction as well. Then how this related to us, the history about how we get into this thing. So it's going to June 2010. So I did a quick start program with a couple of other architects in San Francisco. So then we met this architect who wants to build a complete SOA system, using service-oriented architecture, new system. And he said, I don't want to build just a project. I want to build a platform and then try to come up with an architecture. Then I worked with these architects, and then we identified this a concept called a business service, and then things associated with that platform. So that was the start. And I don't think those days, like even analysts, like they didn't talk about this thing. It's a random thing we identified. And then I shared this spec with Sanjeev. As usual, Sanjeev said, OK, it's great. And then let's continue and with that. Then in April 2011, Sanjeev asked me to pitch to a CEO who was running the biggest department store in Sri Lanka, and she sold the business, and now she's doing some charity for animals. So then Sanjeev asked me to pitch this thing to this lady. Then I created a new slide deck with a new concept. Okay, we have a business service platform, then we have external business service consumers, internal service consumers, current IT infrastructure, and future IT strategies. And the pitch did work perfectly. And then even Sanjeev asked me to write a book, but unfortunately, still I'm writing it. So that's about it. And then around November 2014, two gentlemen, actually one architect from Fidelity, as well as one architect from Jaguar Land Rover, they told me and Paul, there's a new set of concepts are coming with this analyst, take a look. One concept called the concept called System of Systems. Two analysts, like, they are pitching it in two different ways. One called a face layered architecture done by Gartner, and then the next one from the other analyst. So we took a look, and then identified, me and Paul worked and came up with this diagram. I know it's a little complicated, okay, for me, but for some people it's too complicated. And with what are the layers and what are the fundamental stuff should enterprise should have, and then how we can use that into a digital transformation. Then Isabel, from her nice French accent, told, oh, this is too complicated, okay? So then we thought of rework on it and then try to simplify it, but unofficially still I am using this thing and having good discussions with architects. So then Isabel simplified this diagram with help of everybody, and then we identify, okay, this is a platform with a couple of sub-platforms that we call as platform of platforms that contains things like API management, security, analytics, so on and so forth, the things that you learned during yesterday and today. So this is the current state of this, and then again, we are keep on improving this diagram as well. So those are about like technical stuff that we learn, and then identify architecture. Then kind of this was kind of like, so not something planned, that I had to do a talk at the conference that we did in Barcelona about the connected business and connected company. Then I Googled it and identify there's a book called The Connected Company. So I started reading this thing. While reading this, I identify most of the stuff we doing with customers explained in this book, as well as internally as a technology company, things we are doing explained in this book, and more about non-technical stuff, like what are the political and then personal stuff that you have to resolve when you are building a digital business or a connected business, explained in this book. And I highly recommend if you have a chance to read this book. So the lessons from our experience, so doing and building digital business is not something new for us. We have done it with a bunch of customers, as well as we are doing it with many customers as well. So I would like to share some of our experience. There are a lot of things, but I try to identify what we should give priority. So the first thing is build a platform. Like, don't treat it as just a project, because then you can't get the results that you wanted, because you need to add more features and you need to build it as an enterprise solution. So the best way to have a platform approach and then build it as a platform. So that's the first advice we would like to make. Then it should have rich functional capabilities, because you never know the requirements, and you never know the requirements coming from internal as well as external. So it should support a lot of functionalities. Otherwise, people will not use the platform, and they will try to start building their own solutions, like we call them as shadow IT, that they will go and build their own stuff. So having rich functionalities is a must to service your own application developers who's building these digital solutions. Then it has to be seamlessly integrated, because now we talk about real time, and then how we can get this data, how we can do predictive stuff, and like that, like there are a lot of features that we need to provide with these solutions. So it has to be internally integrated as well as externally integrated to get this data with high throughput and then low latency and process this information. Then it has to be API driven because we don't know what type of consumer applications consume these services. So everything has to be exposed as API and provide it as a service. Then the next thing is top-down approach. So what is top-down approach? Because most of the architects, they what they are doing, they identify a set of services or set of data sets, and then expose them as an API and ask people to use it. So that's a bottom-up approach. It doesn't work in like most of the cases. So what we identify as well as recommend, have a top-down approach. Identify the user experience or the user requirement. Identify the application that you are building. And then to build that application, identify the APIs that you require. Then go and figure it out. From where you can get this information, or from where you can get these services. So that way, from the day one, when you expose the APIs, that it will be consumed because there's already application waiting to consume those APIs. So that's an approach. So that way, you can quickly show ROI rather than make it some kind of a technical project. It will provide value for your business. Then you have to create tools and automate. Because this continuous integration, continuous testing, as well as rapid application development, to support this stuff, you need to automate this stuff. So creating tools, actually, I'll tell one experience example from a customer. So one customer who's building, who's in financial sector, so they have this challenge. Most of their services are SOAP savvy, but they want to expose everything using REST. So the normal approach, you take something like an integration platform, like a ESB, and then do the transformation. So this development team, what they did to reduce or the limit to not spend too much time on this transformation, they wrote a tool that you point to the service, the SOAP service, the whistle, and then you give your API definition using Swagger. Once you give these two inputs with some additional information based on case by case, it generates the transformation logic for you. So that creates a huge impact because there was a resistance to do the transformation and then bring these services into REST services. So once they provided the tool, everybody started using it, and then it was a success factor for this project. Then the next thing is to give a code name to the platform. As an example, digital platform or digital framework or any name, or like Nexon or whatever that you like, don't use the vendor names or product names. Because when you start using vendor names or product names, there are usually a lot of political stuff comes, and then people have their own opinions. So to avoid that thing, giving a code name is a really good thing, as well as it's a totally new start for the organization. So that's another thing that we identified while building these projects. Then you should have a proper onboarding program. Because when you introduce a system like this, people will tell, OK, it's a black box. I don't know how to use it. And people naturally, people will reject because people don't like change. That's normal. So you have to get rid of it. The best way to have a proper plan onboarding program. So in that, you should have like samples, because developers, they like to start with a sample. And then it should provide proper documentation. And whatever the patterns that you have identified, it has to be documented. And you should have a proper training program as well. So that way, whenever there's a new team wants to utilize the platform, you can run this program and get them quickly productive. Then the next thing is, once you build a platform, you have to evangelize the platform. Especially internally, you can use different type of medium, and then try to get this into different audiences. Like you can do workshops, you can do webinars, and you can, like, if there's a newsletter going internally, you can tell them about this thing through that newsletter, so and so forth. So evangelizing the platform is a must. And then whenever you do upgrade or add new features, educating the users is a key thing as well. Then now you have a central platform. So you should have a common enterprise architecture practices across the organization. Like to do a certain thing, what are the patterns that you should use? It's not like limiting to use those patterns. Those are the best practices. So that way, people not reinvent everything. They will try to reuse most of these things. It will help to increase the productivity. So, but it's not like a central or a central enterprise architecture team taking these decisions. It's basically getting different architects from different business units and architecture groups and have a common architecture practice and try to push it to different users in the organization. Then the next thing, I think we talked about this in many sessions about iterative nature of the approach, like have a iterative architecture and then iterative development and release this thing in different versions. Like you can start with bring the security platform first and then integration platform first and then internal functionality even you can introduce in an iterative way, because if we try to build the entire platform, then it will take a long time, and then when you finish the platform, it might be not relevant, because most of the stuff that I am talking today are very time sensitive. It might be not valid even tomorrow, because that's how fast the business requirements changing as well as technology changing as well. Then the those are like technical stuff as well as the best practices that we can do from technical team. But most important as well as the critical part is people factor, because there are a lot of people involved in an organization, and whenever you bring a new system or a platform, there are a lot of resistance coming. So as a solution, while working with these groups, what we identify, we need to make sure like they are comfortable, and then to do that, we need to make them engage. And then we had to make them empower, not only enough for engaging and empowering, we had to entrust them as well, and then make them part of your platform, so you will get a lot of help from them. So I think I share this story multiple times, that this new security system, one of the customers, we started building a new security system, and there was an existing security gateway they had written using some Apache technology. And we tried to replace it with our security platform. And this guy who wrote the earlier security gateway, he was keep on telling, this doesn't work, this doesn't work. Then I tried to convince him, but my limited security knowledge didn't help. So I asked Prabhat Sirivardhana, Director of Security Architecture, like the best guy who can talk and convince a guy who's coming from security background. Then Prabhat get into a call, and then he was trying to explain. This guy is telling, no, it doesn't work, it doesn't work. Then Prabhat IM me and tell, OK, that's it, I can't do this, because he's not convincing. Then for some reason, I told that person from his by calling his name, you are the one who's implementing this new system. As long as he heard that thing, he was like totally positive about it. And then he said, okay, let's talk about the design and let's start working on it. The main issue he had a problem. He was like not, like he's insecure, because like he thought he will be out when the new system comes. So that's where like we need to get everybody engaged when we are building a new system and make them part of the new system to make sure that we get full support. To do that, actually, I got this from Dave's book, actually. You should have an open system, because a closed system doesn't support to have that type of practice. So that's where the open system come into the picture. So we don't need to go out and look at open system. So WSO2 is a great example about open system. So Sanjeeva detailed explain about how we do stuff with open culture, and then how we everybody can contribute. So thanks, Sanjeeva, for creating a system like that, as well as maintaining it for us to come up with crazy ideas and build stuff as well as let our customers to use it and be innovative. So the so that's the key thing. You should have an open system to bring these people in on board and then use them to use this stuff. So that's it. So the so I'm part of the conference program structure. So what we plan for Colombo conference, because we identified there are a lot of downloads and there are a lot of usage of our products in other parts of the world, like US and Europe. And by looking at the open source nature and then the capabilities, we were wondering why it's not that much used in this part of the world. So main the thinking behind how we structure the program to like educate you about the technology as well as the other standard behind that. So as a result, we assume there will be a lot of downloads and then there will be a lot of implementation happen in this part of the world as well. So the key goal from this basically to give you a clear understanding about what's the digital transformation or digital enterprise as well as what's the technology that you can use to build that. So if you are a senior technical person in your organization, our goal is like to make you the person who like digitally transform your organization at some point. And if you are an architect or a developer, to make you part of that journey of your organization. And then, end of the day, like make your organization a digital enterprise. That's it. Thank you.